はい、メンバーが揃いました。これで改めて
Thank you. So once again, we'd like to, first I'd like to introduce the panelists. Mr. Roelich Lewin. Next from RRI, Use Case Task Force, Mitsubishi Electric Company, Mr. Baba. Also, Mr. Wolfgang Clausen. Thank you. From RRI Industrial Security Action Group, Mitsubishi Electric Company, Mr. Yoneda. And moderator is served by the head of RRI International Standardization, University of Tokyo, Professor Emeritus, Ms. Dr. Kimura. So, Professor Kimura, the floor is yours. Thank you very much. So, this is a panel discussion, last panel discussion for today. Well, I think most of the audience, I see Japanese faces, so I will be speaking in Japanese. The panel does not have the fixed scenario. But I think after two presentations, well, the last one was talking about the future of the international standardization. We have received several questions from the floor. Actually, there are not many questions from the floor. Well, I feel like I am a student to test the exams. I think I was going through the exams, but I do not have a lot of questions in the exam. So maybe I can actively kind of bring the theme for the panelists. So let's get started. I will be asking questions
maybe
in English.
This question is to the German panelist. The question is, in Germany, it seems that when you discuss about the standardization topics concerning the Industry 4.0, there seems to be some meetings where the experts from different domains get together. For instance, OT side expert, like a machine device expert, operational information expert, or IT experts, or communication experts get together to discuss about the industrial standardization topics, because the standardization topics about industry contains many different aspects of expertise. So in Germany, do you really have such kind of meetings? Or, and in case there, then what kind of discussion and what is the result of that meeting, the effectiveness of that kind of meeting? So maybe Ulrich, can you say something?
I think this is a really critical point, that in the context of Industry 4.0, you have to have discussions between different disciplines, so mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, software engineers, and so on. And when we started our initiative in 2011, or even earlier in the other projects before, we always had the problem that different stakeholders, different disciplines were at the table. You were discussing one day, everybody used the same word, but after the day we understood we are talking about different things. And this is something which we really saw in the beginning of our initiative. And one design criteria for us was, when we established even the first platform, that in each working group, every discipline is participating. So there was no working group like architecture where only computer scientists were. No, there were electrical engineers, computer scientists, mechanical engineers. We had our research working group. There were not only computer scientists, there were other disciplines also. So by construction, in all of the, or in most of the working groups, we had all the different disciplines, and it was really at the beginning a challenge to find this common understanding, this common language. And what, where we succeeded after around about 2 or 3 years, I do not know exactly the time frame, then we published RAMI, RAMI 4.0. And RAMI was the result that everybody of the different disciplines said, now we have a common picture, and now we have this common understanding, where should we talk about? And this was really a hard way to come to this understanding. And even in other working groups, for instance, in the research and innovation working group, we used another approach. We developed these scenarios like value-based service and the other one. And again, different disciplines had to work on this common topic. And what you see, it's not standardization on a very, very deep technical level. No, first of all, you have to guarantee that you have the same picture, that you have the same understanding, that you are talking about the same problems. And this is something which is really challenging. And this was our way how to come to this.
Okay, thank you very much. Dr. Walker, please.
Okay, there's one interesting aspect for this question. Because as security is such a horizontal topic, we always have this problem. When we do some sort of threat analysis and risk analysis for security in a certain environment, we have to talk to integrators, to manufacturers, for users and operators. And especially as many people know, one of the hardest things in security is the user interface. Yeah, it has to be being used without any complications. So in this regard, it is inevitable that there is a discussion with all these disciplines, and we also already talked to the universities that they teach security, industrial security in the future for all disciplines together. Yeah, for the machine engineers and for the software engineers and for the electronic engineers. And there are, as somebody told me, there are some common lectures already planned in the universities so that they get together and get the same wording from the very beginning.
Thank you very much. Maybe I also get some comment from the Japanese members, please.
Thank you. So I think maybe I can rely on the great interpreters, so maybe I will be speaking in Japanese. Well, when it comes to IoT or smart manufacturing, well, I think some people believe that this is a world of IT. So only IT people should discuss IoT or smart manufacturing. But in reality, I think a use case task force is now discussing to really draw the different use cases or different use scenarios for our analytics. And what we found out is it's not just IT players who are able to solve those different challenges. That's my feeling. Let me share my background in the standardization. Up until being involved in the standardization, I was a machine engineer, mechanical engineer. And then I started with a job, and then I came to those standardization. Well, I was able to communicate with the different engineers from different disciplines. Well, a cross-functional or cross-discipline picture is really important, and that's the learning from being involved in this working session or working group.
2 years ago, our RRI industrial security group set up, and then the members from user group and member from vendors and security expert first gathered, and we are talked about the security, but I clearly remember that if we talk about security, the security is a security requirement, security function, or security implementation. They vaguely use the word security, so there are a lot of confusions are there. So our first task is we first identify the business use case, and then the next we identify the system architecture of the business use case, and then if we analyze the security analysis of the system architecture, we finally identify the security requirement, and then security function and implementation. And then we first share this kind of view within a security action group. And this diagram is really helpful for understanding the collaboration with the German side. So I think this kind of effort is really important to share the, a common language and a common diagram. Yeah, that's it.
Okay, thank you very much. The, in Japan, also Germany, the same kind of problems and method to how to attack those issues. okay, so I want to move to the next questions. Next question is given to us in a English, so I literally try to read it. Is there a standard communication protocol in machine-to-machine data exchange? What is a major issue? So, and then we see it's the same problem that we have now discussed. In these questions, the person who raised this question used the word machine. The machine, the interpretation machine depends on maybe the person's background knowledge and some background idea. So anyway, I just open this question as it is and then want to ask some response to the panelist. So, Rich, could you make some?
And you already started this discussion. I think, what is a machine? If you ask somebody from manufacturing, then he says this is a robot. If you ask somebody from healthcare, from smart healthcare, then he said maybe a smartwatch is a machine, or a device is a machine. So the term machine is not clearly defined and depends on the domain. And now if we are looking to Industry 4.0, so our customer domain is manufacturing industries. So if we are talking about manufacturing industries, then I think we have a clear understanding that a machine mainly is a production machine, a robot, a transportation system, and so on and so on. And if we focus to this topic, then from our perspective, there is one standard which is really emerging, and let me say it's somehow the IoT standard in smart manufacturing, and this is OPC UA. And this is something which we see has established in the market, but as I said, there are some requirements which are satisfied by these machines which you have in manufacturing. If you look to other machines, then often it's not possible to use OPC UA for different reasons. So this exactly depends on the domain and on your understanding. What do you think, what is a machine?
Okay, thank you very much. Also, if I see the OPC UA, it's in roughly saying it's a communication protocol framework. So if you want to communicate some of the basic semantics of machine, then you need to define some component standard. So there are several levels of difference of data. So anyway, there are several existing standards, like emerging standards concerning these topics. But Wohan, could do some comments?
From the security point of view, or let's say from our security point of view, the important thing is, if there are new standards emerging, there should be security built in from the very beginning. That's security by design. Otherwise, we somehow don't care how the communication protocol looks like. We have to provide security for this environment. Yeah. The constraints and performance constraints, these are determined in the first run by other people, and we have to work together with them to look how we can include the necessary security features, for instance, integrity, authenticity, or authentication in this case. Not always confidentiality, that is in industry a little bit different than in the human communication area, and how we can make running and operating. What's your opinion?
I think that from the layer 3 level for using the HTTP or PCUA, there are already some kind of standard already in use, and this is depend on the definition of the machine. And yesterday, we Japan side security joint team have a really interesting discussion on if the machine-to-machine communication means the machine-to-machine online contract. This is the field of blockchain. And then the machine-to-machine online contract has another level of difficulty because it is the legal issue is included, and this kind of issue is introduced by Bolshke, right? So, but in the near future, the machine automatically contract with other machine and exchange information. So this kind of future would come. So this kind of new area is also within our scope of a discussion. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Very interesting comment. Do you have some more? It's okay.
Yeah. Actually, I'm done working for the industrial network standardization. So, but just considering that communication, that this idea itself is a really old. Actually, so in 1950s, the Nobel winner expected controlling the very complex system with achieving digital communication. That it's 1950s. Since then we are considering a lot of the communication ways. Then currently, so just for the industry network, there are more than 20 industry network existing. So, and all each industry network has each purpose. So. So it in that meaning, we've already done for the such machine-to-machine communication, but now we are facing a newer application or we are facing some newer use cases. So in such cases, we need more new such communication way. That OPCUA is also one idea. This is just my idea.
Thank you very much.
Maybe I can
add something.
I could add something on that. The future requirements we face, there is something going on in fifth generation mobile communication, which will be very important in the future. And there is also a question regarding security. And we went into that and realized that in the past, in the mobile communication area, there were no security requirements which were coming from an industrial environment considered. We had just this one use case. We had to secure the billing for the business to consumer network usage. Yeah, that was more or less all what was done in security. But of course, we need much more to use such protocols for future communication between factories, between sites, between machines. And that's the reason we, from the German side at least, intended now participation in 5G definition and standardization to make sure that we get industrial capable results, not just B2C results, which we have to make afterwards on the industrial arena. And so we will never be finished. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe we switch to some general discussion. And I have one general question to the panelist. We talked about the platform, the digital platform, but according to Dr. Kagerman's talk also, we interpret digital platform in a different way, maybe from the rather high level, very general platform down to the very specific implementation, like OpenAS or something like that, or some individual commercial systems. In this situation, how do you think about the standardization of digital platform in terms of enhancing the interoperability? It's a very general question, so that you can say a very general comment. Are you sure about that?
Let me try to start, because we have at the moment internally within Siemens exactly this discussion, that we want to understand what is our understanding of digital platform. And we are at the moment creating a mind map where we are trying to look for different examples and trying to understand what are there for different kinds of platform. There are IoT platforms, there are marketplaces, there are transaction platforms, there are e-shops, there are infrastructure platforms like a cloud computing platform. And even there is something, a product of Siemens Teamcenter, it's a collaboration platform. And so you see, if you want to talk about this topic platform, there are many, many different understandings, and we are at the moment in a learning phase. We are trying to understand what different platforms do we know, and especially how do we think can we use this platform in new business scenarios. We do not want to discuss it from a technical point of view, but we want to discuss scenarios where such a platform can generate benefits to the customers. And I think this is somewhere in a starting point where we really have to think about, and we have to integrate again different stakeholders, especially also academia. They have also some ideas what is a platform and how to do business with platforms.
Yes, I understand it's very difficult to go into the details at this moment, but if you have some comments from the standpoint of security or related topics.
Okay, from the viewpoint of security, the advantage of the platform is many different type of cooperation system can join the platform, and a lot of customer can get the service from the platform, right? But lately, if some business system had a really malicious activity to the platform, everybody has affected by the act. And for example, a few days ago, Japan stock market, Japan stock exchange stopped, you know, and then for a few hours. And this is because of the one brokerage, it is alleged to be the Merrill Lynch Japan, has put a vast amount of traffic to the Tokyo Stock Exchange. And then, as a result, some brokerage interrupt the processing the order, but they have to get the order from the customer, and there are a lot of loss they have. And then, who is liable and why? And this is unclear now. So I think that if some company join or connect to the platform, not only the service level agreement, but also some security level agreement or trustworthiness agreement is needed. And then if the company don't have the enough trustworthy level, they are not allowed to join the platform. So this kind of system is needed from the viewpoint of security.
Yeah, maybe it's similar for any sort of distributed architecture, that in terms of security, this is a common responsibility. Yeah. Not only one of the stakeholders can be responsible for ensuring the security of the result. Yeah. And this, of course, is especially important with platforms. Yeah? And we have, when we identify such constructions, we have immediately, from the security point of view, think about different stakeholders, their responsibilities, and how this can be combined to get an architecture which works at the end.
Thank you. So, ask a comment?
So, yeah, so I'd like to add some comment on Ulrich. So, so this is our motivation, Japanese team's motivations. So, as Ulrich explained, that such application scenario and the platform is a really software-based industries. So it means that the system-oriented system. So it means that if we don't design it, so it does not come true. So what I really want to say is, now Japanese have a really strong manufacturing system. So, but such that and such that Japanese manufacturing isn't designed on the platform, that it doesn't come true. This becomes our big behind, and also. Concept is really useful for the other countries' people. So we'd like to add such kind of Japanese concept on the platform that we are working for this project.
May I add one additional comment to this platform story? And if I am looking to my company, and if you look to the internet and search for Siemens platform, then I think you will get the most hits for digital enterprise platform. So this is a portfolio element which we deliver to the customer. And if you really want to understand what is it, this is something that our customer can use the platform to build a product or a system or solution or a service. And then our customer sells this product solution to his customer, again, to generate a value. So this is something where you also can look to platforms from a perspective that a platform helps somebody to build a product which generates value for his customer. And this is a complete different perspective now. I am not talking about technology, and for sure MindSphere is part of this platform. And so you see how complex this discussion can be, depending on the perspective or your concerns, how to address this topic.
Yes, I understand. So maybe now time is short. Very quick questions, the last question. You talked about the administration shell in relation with the platform. But administration shell is where the administration shell is located in the total perspective of platform, the core part or some components or technology. What do you think about that?
I think this depends on your view on administration shell. From my perspective, you should start with business scenarios. And in business scenarios, you do not need an administration shell, because administration shell is something technical. And if you now go down and describe use cases, then you can see, okay, in these use cases, you need common tasks to solve. And there can the asset administration shell can be used as a technical concept to solve common problems which you have in many use cases. And then you can switch over from the concept of the asset administration shell to the implementation of the asset administration shell. And maybe then you are on a level like digital platform from a technical point of view. So I think it depends somehow on your perspective on the topic.
Okay, thank you very much. The time is short, but do you want to have some comment in terms of this area?
I really understand there's a platform from the viewpoint of creating the value for the customer, and not only the technical side. I really understand a different viewpoint. Thank you very much.
Okay, so time is now almost over. The main topics of this session was the platform and its standardization. And as we discussed now, the concept digital platform itself is not so well shared among the many different domains of people. So I think it's still very interesting to work on that concept, then go into some detailed technical discussion. So I think it's a good start to think about these issues. And thank you for your participation and also the very good contribution for the panelists. Thank you very much.
モデレーターの木村先生、そしてパネリスト。
So, Dr. Kimura, as well as all the panelists, thank you very much.